most of all for Jesus Christ, who, if you allow him, will break all chains. Thank you, God.
As a teenager, before I knew Christ, I struggled with doubt and confidence and depression. All this stemmed from trying to please others and trying to make friends, but just failing over and over. The harder I tried, the more it drove people away. But I had a neighbor who knew Jesus. She lived her life differently. She prayed for me daily like a grandma. And through her ministry, I accepted Jesus as my Savior. And he changed me. I'm not perfect, but I am forgiven. And today I ask you to follow Jesus and change someone's life by loving your neighbor as yourself.
Hace 2 años vine a este país con una maleta y sola, y después de 2 años confiando en las promesas de Dios, Él me ha dado un esposo, una familia, un ministerio, una familia en Cristo. Él es fiel. He's faithful. Amen.
I was lost and empty, attempting life my way to no avail. In turning to Jesus, the way, the light, and the Lord, I live with passion and clarity, walking in His grace and sharing His love with others, knowing I have a divine purpose.
Dios ha sido tan bueno conmigo y me siento afortunada y agradecida desde lo más profundo de mi corazón. A pesar de todas las pruebas y dificultades que he pasado, Él siempre ha estado a mi lado y ha sido fiel. He sido bendecida con mi vida y mi familia y me ha dado toda la paz que necesito.
En el 2018 yo dejé mi trabajo sin tener otro y un domingo en la iglesia Dios me dedicó 4 canciones y en mi teléfono las tengo así. Canciones de Dios para mí. Me estaba acordando, confía en mí que nunca te he fallado.
I was bound by the chains of abuse, addiction, anxiety, and depression. But Jesus broke the chains and used what the enemy meant for evil for the saving of many lives.
When I was a young girl, I would play with my brothers after dinner. For a short period of time, I had to stop, play with my brothers, and I was drawn to my parents' bedroom window to look up out to the sky. That is where the Lord revealed himself to me. Therefore, he is my only security.
Even though I've been a Christian for about 25 years, since I was 25 years old, I left the church because I didn't see the point at all. But Fairview really fills that need for church in me. And Jesus does the rest.
I was a confused people pleaser, full of worldly desires. Now I'm renewed, I'm restored, and I'm redeemed. I'm now made new in Christ Jesus, and I do all things for the glory of God our Father.
we worship you, we lift you up. And this morning is different than other Sunday mornings. Lord, today is the day we celebrate when you rose from the dead. They had written you off, said, "That's it. I guess he wasn't the one." But the story wasn't over. The miracles, they didn't stop. You rose and forgave the sins of all of us. No amount of works or good deeds that we can do will ever be enough to cover our sin. We needed a sacrifice, and you loved us enough to hang on a cross. So God, we worship you today. We love you. It is in Jesus' risen name that we pray. Amen. Amen. He is risen. There it is. Happy Easter, everyone. So glad you're here. Wonderful to see everybody. Everyone online, thank you so much for joining us. Happy Easter. Listen, this service is about life change. We want to see God work and give you an opportunity to respond. If at any point in this service, you feel the Holy Spirit tugging, pushing you to just get closer, you can be baptized in this service. There's no, we don't make it a whole big thing where you got to fill out 20 pages of paperwork. If God moves in your heart this morning, we want you to respond. So don't worry about clothes. We've got clothes for you. We want you to answer God when he calls. So if you feel it this morning, if you say, today is the day, respond. We want you to. We want to see that change. Amen? Amen. So we've got a little bit of time here. There are so many people. Go make some new friends. Say happy Easter. And when the video comes up, have a seat. And if you want to get baptized, there's a big light back there. That's our baptism control light. Go back, all right? Make some friends when the video pops up. Have a seat. Thanks.
Happy Easter and welcome to the Village. We are so glad that you are here celebrating with us today. Whether it's your first time or it's your 100th time, we want to get to know you. So hop in the chat, say hey to our greeters, ask for prayer, ask any questions. They are there to connect with you and to help you have a great experience with us today. Today is Resurrection Sunday. We are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus, and we want you to know you can experience resurrection in your life. So think about the power of Jesus. Think about the words that are said today. And if you feel like you need a next step, get here. It's not too late to get baptized, to connect with some people face to face. We would love to see you. Happy Easter. Here we go.
Started playing baseball all the way from when I was 5 years old and t-ball, and then as I got older, I started realizing I was pretty good at throwing a ball hard, and so I became a pitcher and I fell in love with it. And eventually, I was spending 2-3 hours a day just training to pitch, training to throw harder, training to be better, and it ultimately became who I was. Eventually, it wrote into my heart and my mind, like, that's my value. You know, it's baseball, that's me. And then I got to college, and with baseball being my idol, I was like, this is what I'm meant to do, this is who I'm meant to be. And then I started experiencing failure and failure and failure and failure. But because baseball at that time was my God, I was super lost and super confused, and I started to get more depression, more anxiety, and I started having panic attacks, and I'm like, man, like, this is my identity, and I'm failing at it. There was a day, I woke up and it was weird. Like, I didn't want to get out of bed. And it wasn't because like I was tired or I didn't want to face a test or something. It was, I felt like there was a ton of bricks on my chest. And I woke up and I literally didn't know why I was alive. Like I didn't know what the reason for me to keep living was. And that hit me pretty hard. And I felt like I was sinking into my bed and kind of all this emotion and stuff kind of hit me all at once. And I was like, something's got to change. And that was the turning point. Everything didn't change all at once, but that was when I started to steer the ship a little bit. Around the same time, I was at a church service and the pastor called us up and he said, we're doing something different today. You know, we're gonna have spontaneous baptisms. And I was there with my mom and I just felt like I was called to go and get baptized. And so I can only describe it as like the Holy Spirit really tugging on my heart and telling me, hey, it's time to take this step for me. And so I did, I went and I got baptized. God started transforming me by making me, like I said, I don't know how to explain it. He started just filling up that loneliness and that emptiness, and he started giving me a purpose to life. You know, I started to change my heart and my thinking, and I'm not here for baseball. I'm here for God and to glorify him. And when I met Lizzie too, I feel like that was like the last point. That was the turning point. And I told her one day, I'm like, hey, this is the direction that I want to take my life. And when she said that she was all in with that, I was like, you know, let's do this. Let's start living our lives for Jesus. I was talking to a friend yesterday about how important it is to find someone who shares that faith with you. And Lizzie was that answered prayer for me. And she's super, super important in my faith journey because, you know, without her, I've had hard times, you know, I've had faith struggles and she has as well. And we're always there to lean on one another and to bring each other out of those, help bring each other out of those times. So when we first moved down here, I got a scholarship to play for Villanova. It was a lot of transition all at once, especially for Lizzie. She got married, moved away from her community, and started a new job. So it was all a lot of things happening at once, and that it put a lot of strain on her. And I knew when we were down here, we needed to plug in. We needed to find a community that would help support us in our marriage and in our struggles. Finally, you know, Lizzie and I got on our knees like we do every night and we prayed and said, God, please bring us a church and a community that we can fall in love with that's gonna help support us while we're down here. And the next church that we went to was Fairview and we fell in love with it. So the small group that Lizzie and I are in, it's a marriage group run by Harry. And that's also just been an awesome way that we've met just some really awesome people. They've been also super supportive. We go in there, we walk in, we have a huge smile on our face, and we walk out, we're still smiling, laughing, and joking about things. And we also have some really in-depth conversations about marriage and about God and about faith. And it's just nice to have a time each week that Lizzie and I can go somewhere, be surrounded by people who value what we value, and talk about some hard questions and talk about marriage and we can just walk through life together. You know, people go through some hard things in that community and we're all there for each other. When I went all in with Jesus, I started getting my cup started to fill, you know, it started to overflow onto other people. So yeah, go all in, because being half in, half out, it doesn't work. I've tried it and I know people very close to me who have tried it and it leaves you feeling empty. So take that step, be baptized, and be set free.
Thank you, Sal, for that testimony and everybody else that shared their resurrection story this morning. We appreciate that. That encourages us. You might have seen Sal setting up chairs at the back of the worship center during this service, but thanks for all of those resurrection stories. He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
So I read this week. It actually shocked me. I was a little befuddled by it. I was trying to figure out how it made sense. But I read this week that they were estimating that 64% of everybody that lived in the United States would be in a worship service this morning celebrating the risen Savior. Is that incredible? That's over 220 million people that have gathered together to celebrate the risen Savior. So it caused me to think, why? Like, why are so many people gathering? And I decided this is my answer to that. After 2,000 years, no matter how broken we are, no matter how far we have fallen, no matter how deep we are buried, no matter the size of the obstacles that are placed upon us, our God is still in the business of resurrection. That He does not desire for us to be held down. That by His power and strength, each one of us can experience a resurrection in our life. If God reached down into the tomb and He quickened Jesus back to life, then He can do the very same thing for us. Praise His name. That's why I think 220 million people are gathered together this morning to celebrate that fact, the hope of who He is. And I don't know if you knew this, but even baptism, right? We're going to have baptisms at the end of the service, and it was mentioned. But you know, baptism itself is like, it symbolizes the resurrection. That's what it is. I mean, man, when you get baptized and you get into that pool of water and you are taken down underneath the water represents the ground. And as the water comes up over your head, it represents that you have died to self. It represents death. And then you are brought up out of the water and it represents a resurrected life in Christ. So I want to say this morning. Last service, we had six people that decided spontaneously, hey, I'm going to get baptized this morning. They weren't planning on it before they came, but they came and they decided the Lord was speaking to them, so they got baptized. So I want to say this. Nicole's at the back of our worship center right now, and you see that she has the light, the blinking red light, right? She can land the baptism plane for you this morning. So you just go back to the blinking red light and Nicole will help land that plane anytime this morning. At the end of the service, we're going to baptize 12 people. So we're excited about that. Praise the Lord for that. So here, the greatest event in human history. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the woman hurried away from the tomb, after afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." Let's pray. Jesus, I praise you so much for the fact of the resurrection. I praise you that the resurrection changed the course of history itself. And I praise you that your desire for every single one of us is to have our own resurrection. That no matter how far we go, no matter how much we're beat up, no matter where it is that we land, that Jesus, you are with us. Lord, help us this morning by the power of your Spirit to recognize your presence near us and to respond to you. Lord, lift up each one of us in your resurrection power. We pray, amen. Every one of us, no one is excluded, needs a resurrection. You know, the Bible tells us in Romans 3:23, it says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." That means we need a resurrection. All have sinned. There's not one exception in this room or on the globe. John 16:33, the words of Jesus. Jesus says this, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble." So Jesus himself, God's word tells us that oftentimes this world is not kind to us. We face hardships and we face difficulties. And sometimes those knock us down and they drag us out. And we need a resurrection even from the world itself. You know, for some of us that's gathered together here today, trouble has got the best of us. We're not living out the resurrection in our daily lives. We're not living in resurrection power. Life has happened to us, and we recognize when we hear this, we need a resurrection. We need a resurrection to renewed relationships, to victory and strength and confidence. We need a fresh perspective. We need hope revived. We need rekindled love and tenderness. We need a real movement in our hearts and lives in the face of very real grief. We need new purpose for living. And the good news for us is that this Sunday always reminds us that God is in the business of resurrections. In fact, the resurrection story in the scripture is repeated over and over again. And the plot of the resurrection, it's always the same. So here's the narrative. People sin or circumstances affect them. And difficulties come. They get knocked down. And then God redeems and restores. That's the plot of every resurrection story. So there's two things that always knock us out. The first is our choices. Sometimes we make bad choices. Sometimes the choices we make are sinful and not in alignment with what God desires for us. We lack a level of wisdom in life. No one in this room can ever say every decision I made was perfect. All of us have made bad decisions. We've made mistakes. We've sinned. But whatever the motivation is for our decision, we can end up being knocked down and out. The second thing that often knocks us down and out is just circumstances itself. The circumstances that surround us. It doesn't take long to look around our world and see how much the world needs a resurrection. We look around and we see people that are angry about this and folks that are angry about that. We see war. We see hostility. We see levels of kindness not taking place between people. And we see this and we think to ourselves, we need hope. We need something to look into. We need Jesus to look into. The storm of life, financial collapse, illnesses, someone else's choice that impacts us. Oftentimes, circumstances knock us down. But when our resurrection comes, now I want you to hear that. I didn't say if, I said when our resurrection comes. Because here's the reality, Jesus has your resurrection planned. He already does. He already knows how he's gonna move. He already knows what he's gonna do. He already knew you were gonna be here this morning. Jesus already has hope for you in place for life. And when our resurrection comes, it normally happens in one or two ways. One way it happens is that God empowers us to overcome obstacles that are in our way. Right? And you can read through the scriptures and you see time after time that God delivers the plan, or God delivers the wisdom, or God delivers the strength, or God delivers the people, or God delivers the resources to overcome the obstacles that we face. Another way that our resurrection comes is that Jesus redeems the worst of our circumstances. I mean, Jesus he shows up in the midst of our difficult circumstances and he brings us new life. He brings us new hope. He brings us a future. I mean, that's the plot of every resurrection story in Scripture. Like if we go back to Genesis, we'd start in the Garden of Eden, right? We start at the creation of the world. There's Adam and Eve. And the story is Adam and Eve make a sinful choice, right? They decide that they're going to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that God said would not be good for them. But they disobeyed him and they did it anyhow. Well, what happens is because they did that, they realized all of a sudden that they were broken. They realized their nakedness. They realized their shame. Ultimately, they were removed from the Garden of Eden. But yet, even in the midst of that, even in the midst of their sinful choice, you see God's activity on their behalf, right? He gives them a covering for their brokenness. He gives them a new purpose and a new hope that they can live into, and he keeps them going. I mean, that's a resurrection story of God's activity in the midst of even choice against him. Like, you see Abraham in the Old Testament. Abraham is given a promise from God that he'll have a child and he'll become a great nation, that a promised child was going to be delivered to him and Sarah. But Abraham became impatient. He was like, what's taking God so long? He didn't like the delay. So he laid with another woman and he had a son, Ishmael. And he tried to make Ishmael the promise of God. Well, he wasn't the promise of God. What happened was Ishmael created chaos in Abraham's home and in his family, created division. But in spite of Abraham's poor choices, in spite of his impatience, God still moved upon Abraham. And Abraham was still given the promised child in Isaac. And Abraham became, through Isaac, a great nation. I mean, a resurrection story where hope was not gone. Hope wasn't gone because of a sinful choice. Hope wasn't gone because of impatience. And then we look at Moses, and here Moses is. And if you know the story of Moses, you know Moses is a fellow who dealt with anger issues, right? Moses was quick to anger and quick to respond and very emotional. In fact, one day he got so angry, he murdered a man. And then he buried him in the sand. And what happened was he ended up being banished to the wilderness. Like, Moses thought, my life is over. It's done. He had fallen from a height. It's over for him. But yet, even in the wilderness, God speaks to him and he calls him back. He restores Moses, and then ultimately he frees thousands of slaves through Moses. And do you know the Easter event? The Easter event is the foundation for every resurrection event in history. Easter is the ultimate resurrection. And think about, do you know this begins the story? The story takes place in the most horrific of places. Like, you've heard these words before. Golgotha, that's the Hebrew. Calvary, that's the Latin. Cranium, that's the Greek. But all three of them, in whatever language, are all translated the same. They're translated as the skull, the place of the skull. This is the place where Jesus was crucified. Now, archaeologists, they've excavated the area, and they've determined that this place, the skull, at one time served as the city of Jerusalem's landfill. It was their garbage dump. Now, have you ever been to a landfill? I've been to multiple landfills, right, throughout my life, emptying garbage, dumping out construction, whatever. I've been to multiple landfills. And you could take it from my testimony, but you've probably been there yourself. There's never been a landfill that I've been at that is a scenic view. I mean, the landfill assaults your senses in every way. It doesn't look good. It doesn't feel good. It smells horrific. Well, this landfill, the place of the skull, was outside the city walls of Jerusalem. Not only was it where everybody dumped their garbage and all of it rotted and the smell it just flowed out of the place, it was also the location where the Romans performed their executions. And oftentimes, after they did an execution, nobody would claim the body. So you know what they did with the bodies that they took down off the cross? They would just toss them onto the landfill. So you can imagine, not only is there garbage that's rotten and all the junk that's around and all the fumes that come from that, but there is also decomposing bodies in this landfill. It doesn't add a lot to the reputation, doesn't lessen the assault on the senses. It is absolutely one of the worst places you could ever imagine. Now, I want you to think about this. This was the location. This was Golgotha, where Jesus decided to plant his cross. I mean, Jesus planted his cross in this landfill, which says something to us. Did you know what it says to us? It says that Jesus will go anywhere for you. You're not beyond his reach. Your garbage can't compare to where it is that he drove his cross. Whatever sin has done to you, wherever circumstances have taken you, it's never too late for you. And you've never gone too far. Your garbage does not scare Jesus. Jesus plants his cross in the middle of all of our garbage. And it's absolutely essential that we understand this. We understand that a resurrection, like if we hope for a resurrection, if we hope for something different in our life, we have to understand that every true resurrection begins and ends with God's work. I mean, he always makes the first move. Like you know in the biblical story, Jesus is God's first move towards you. Right? I mean, here Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, and he wraps himself in flesh, and he comes down and he lives a while among us. And then he goes to the cross on our behalf to take all of our garbage and all of our wrongdoing, all of our ill-advised decisions, all of our sin, he takes upon himself. I mean, Jesus is God's first move towards you. Then we have to decide, how do we respond to Jesus? Like, if that's God's first move to us, Jesus is the first move, then how do we respond to Jesus? Now, we know that God's expecting a response because we see it in the story. It's all over the story. Like for instance, in the story itself, when Jesus' cross is planted in Golgotha, in the midst of that landfill, in all of that garbage, do you know he was not crucified there alone? I mean, you know the story. He was crucified between two thieves. And those two thieves show us the different responses to Christ. Right? Our choices. How are we going to respond to him? I mean, he's planted his cross in the middle of our garbage, in the middle of our junk. Now, how are we going to respond to him? He is present with us. Well, the first thief just rejects Jesus. He rejects him and he insults him. In fact, in Luke 23:39, it says this: one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Then save yourself and save us. Now think about his response. Here Jesus is joining him in all of his garbage. Right? God just shows up in the midst of all of this junk. And what the thief decides to do is the thief decides to insult them. And can you imagine how much energy it must take that thief with his last breath to hurl insult? Can you imagine how much pain? Like I don't know how much you know about like a crucifixion, right? But a crucifixion, they basically drive two big spikes through your wrist right here where all of your nerve endings are, which create great pain. And then they drive a great big spike through your ankles, through all the nerve endings that gather there, which creates big, you know, great pain. And then you're hanging on this cross, right? And as you're hanging there, right, you're hanging there, and all of the weight of your body is falling on your lungs. So you can't breathe. I mean, the weight of your body is pressing against your lungs and you can hardly get in breath and you're in so much pain. And the only way to get a breath is to elevate yourself, is to lift yourself up. So here this first thief, he's on the cross and he's taking all of the energy and all of the pain to like lift his body up, to suck in a little bit of air. And then he decides to use the air to hurl insult. Like he could only get in a little bit of air, and how he chooses to use it is rejection and insult. You know what this tells us? This tells us that the pain this thief is going through isn't just the pain of this day. It isn't just the pain of the spikes that are in his wrist and the spikes that are in his ankles. It is a lifetime of pain that has built up in him. There's a lifetime of hostility and anger and disappointment and disillusionment that's in him. And man, he is in his dying breath still spewing out the venom of all of this pain. Do you know that's a major danger for each one of us? For every one of us, it's like our garbage just doesn't tend to stay out here somewhere. Our garbage tends to take residence in here, and it tends to take residence in here. And it affects us. It affects the way we think. It affects the way we feel. It affects the way we see things. I don't happen to think that it's an accident that Jesus was crucified at the place called the skull, the cranium, because Jesus wanted to drive his cross not only into the middle of all of our garbage, but he also wanted to drive his cross into the middle of the way we think. He wanted to drive that cross into the pattern of our thinking. He wanted us to look at ourselves and to look at the world and to look at others differently than we tended to do. I mean, in Romans 12, the Apostle Paul says this: do not conform to the pattern of this world. Don't think like the world thinks. Right? Don't act like the world acts. Don't see things the way the world sees things. And then he goes on to say, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And for some of us, and right, it's almost impossible to stop, but for some of us, that garbage has gotten in and it's affected our perspective, and our survival mode has become to attack and to insult and to blame and to spew venom. I mean, the hurt has gone so deep that our defense mechanisms are always up, even against those that are trying to help us. We're just in constant attack mode. But then, at the very same landfill, nailed to the cross on top of the same pile of garbage, another option is presented to us. Another choice of how we're going to respond to Jesus in the middle of all of our junk. And the other thief responds totally different. The other thief recognizes the presence of Christ and asks him for help. Here's what it says. But the other criminal rebuked him, the former criminal. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we're getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. So we have one criminal that all the garbage got inside of him and messed him up. His response was negative and rejecting. And then we have another one who somehow gains perspective in this moment. In the middle of being crucified in the garbage, he understands the gravity of the moment. He recognizes that God has met him there. Now I'd assume both of these thieves had an idea who Jesus was, right? They probably seen him around town because Jesus is at an all-time height in popularity. I mean, right before the triumphal entry where it says the whole town was stirred, everybody was showing up, everybody was hearing him teach, everybody was seeing his miracles. He had just raised Lazarus from the dead. I mean, this Jesus is at like, he's at like celebrity status. So I have no doubt that these criminals probably had seen him around town. They probably had seen him heal somebody, or they heard about the healing, or they happened to catch some of his teaching. They happened to see him helping people along the way. And this criminal decided that he was going to use his last breath differently than the first one. So rather than insulting or striking out, this criminal decided to recognize divinity in his presence, and he reached out to him. So listen to his prayer. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me. And there is a very real fear about being forgotten, isn't there? There's a fear that people are going to push us aside, that we're not going to matter, that we're just going to be shrugged off to the edge. There's a fear of being invisible in all of the stuff we deal with in life. But you know, Jesus planting himself on the garbage dump in the skull between two thieves tells us God does not forget. He doesn't forget. God doesn't forget you. It doesn't matter what decisions you've made or what pain you're in or what your circumstances are. God does not forget. Man, you want to do something that'll revolutionize your life. Man, this week, after all your Easter festivities are done, go tomorrow and begin to do a word study in the Bible about God remembers. You are going to be overwhelmed what God remembers. Listen to what just one verse says he remembers. God remembers his covenant forever. The promise he made for 1,000 generations. He remembers. Jesus remembers. Jesus knows. He remembers. He's active with you now. So here's what Jesus does. When the thief on the cross says, "Remember me," Jesus responds to his request. And he says this. He says, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." From the landfill, from the garbage dump, from all of the things that assault your senses, to paradise itself. Now, I think this is true. There's some of us that are here this morning and we need to make a move. Like, we need to make a turn in our life, right? We need to turn our circumstances over to him. We need to take the things that we think are overwhelming us and they're holding us down and they're beating us up, and we just need to give them to him, right? We need to allow him to change us and to change our perspective about him, right? We need to give him room to move. And then there's some of us here this morning that we need to seek his forgiveness because we've lived life our own way. We've lived our life where we weren't worried about him remembering us because we weren't remembering him. Like, we were just living life with not worried about what his desire was or his plan was or his hope was for us. We just lived life, and the junk is just piled up all around us, and we've done our best to try to remove it. We tried to stay on top of the pile, but the pile was still there, and the pile made its way in us, into our head and into our heart. And then we need our heart and our minds renewed by him. Man, there's many of us here today that we just need to trust Christ for the forgiveness of all of our wrongdoing, all of our failures, all of our sin. Man, he has planted himself in the middle of all of our junk to say, "I'm here," and he offers us hope. "I have not forgotten you. I am remembering you." We need to allow him to give us a whole new direction and a whole new life. Man, every one of us needs a resurrection. So I tell you what I'm going to do this morning. I'm going to say a word of prayer. And my prayer specifically is going to be about asking Jesus to forgive me for just going my own way. Right? Just doing my own thing. I'm going to ask him to forgive me for my rebellion towards him or my lack of acknowledgement of him. I'm going to ask for his grace and his forgiveness. That's what I'm going to pray about specifically. And some of you this morning, you need to pray that prayer with me. You could repeat my words. That's not what's important. But he just needs to know from you in your heart and in your mind that, like, I'm ready. Jesus, you have planned my resurrection. I am ready for this. The scripture says, man, he washes us with hyssop and we will be white as snow. When was the last time you felt that? Like, man, I'm clean. In spite of all my bad choices, in spite of all my negative thinking, in spite of all my garbage, he wipes us clean. Man, he resurrects us. I mean, some of us need to pray that prayer this morning. There's some of us here that we've prayed that prayer, but we've allowed circumstances to overwhelm us. And we need a resurrection over our circumstances. We need to believe that he has a plan for us. We need to ask him and live into that. Get our new perspective in what we're going through. So this morning I'm going to pray. And if you're here this morning, you're like, yeah, I need that. I need the forgiveness of Christ to reset me, to resurrect me. Man, today's your day, because that is the business that God is in. He has your resurrection planned. So with every head bowed, every eye closed this morning, I'm going to say a word of prayer again. You can repeat after me, say your own words, but Jesus, I am a sinner and I need a Savior. And I confess right now that I've been heading my own direction. I've been doing my own thing. I've been following my own path, and it hasn't gotten me to where it is that I thought I was going. But Lord, my life's been filled up with all sorts of different things. It's affected the way I think. It's affected the way I feel. It affects the way I respond to others. And Jesus, I don't want that anymore. Lord, I need your grace and your mercy and your love. I believe that you are who you say you are. And I believe that what you did on the cross at Calvary and through the resurrection is sufficient for my salvation. I believe that the resurrection that you, Lord, lived out before us is what you desire to happen in me, in my heart and in my mind. So Jesus, right now, I turn from all of those other ways and I turn to you. And right now in this moment, I receive your resurrection plan for me. I receive your forgiveness, your grace. Now, Jesus, help me. Help me to walk in this path. Help me to respond appropriately. Help me to make sure that I stay in the light and I learn about the light and I learn what all of that means to walk in your presence. Jesus, thank you so much for your grace and your mercy and your sacrifice and your offer of resurrection to me. I praise you, Jesus, and I pray this in your name. Amen. So, all right, that's a good thing. Praise the Lord. Now I want to say this. If you prayed that prayer this morning, boy, you could, right, we would love for you to share that with us. So there's a card on your seat. You can fill that card out, put it in the basket when it goes by, or you could click, you know, take a picture of a little QR code and do it digitally if you'd like. I mean, we only ask you to do that because we want to be a resource to you. We want to help you. We don't want you to journey through life alone, right? We want to journey through life together and following him. So please let us know that and make us aware of that. And then I want to say this. There's some of us here this morning that even though we did not plan this, it was the farthest thing from our mind. We ought to be baptized this morning. It's the symbol of the resurrection. We ought to be baptized. I mean, man, we ought to go underneath and say, yes, this is the witness and the testimony. It is, I am being resurrected by him. I mean, you know, Jesus commands it in the scripture as the symbol to declare to ourselves and everybody else that he has brought us to life. So don't delay. Don't be nervous, right? Man, I mean, we've got the flashing light right back here. Nicole is going to land that baptism plane for you. She is going to take care of you, right? If you're like, oh man, we got clothes for you. We have towels for you. We have, you name it, we've got it for you. You could take one or two people with you, your closest family and friends that are with you to into the room to be baptized. But we ought to respond today to God's call. So we're going to stand. We're going to worship. Nicole's going to keep the red light waving back there so you know where to go. But let's stand and let's celebrate the risen Savior.
declarations of resurrection today. Can we just celebrate that? Can we celebrate again? Amen. Amen. Hey, some of you watched all those baptisms and you felt, man, I missed my chance. I have good news. You didn't miss your chance. All right, there's going to be pastors here for who knows how long as we need to be here. So there's still a red wand back in the back. So if you're still feeling like it's time to get baptized, it's time to tell to the world that you have been resurrected, then go to that red wand right now. We'll still baptize you. If you're online, my email is in the chat. Email me. We'll wait around. We'll baptize you when you get here if you want to do it right now, if you want to proclaim that Jesus has changed your life. All right, so there's still time. Everybody look around. There's a lot of people in here, a lot of people. So many of you have stories of resurrection, and other people in this room need to hear them. That's why we come together. That's why we gather together, because there are people whose lives have been changed by Jesus, and it's going to help somebody else in this room. So get to know somebody. Talk to somebody new on your way out. I know you have dinner, but connect with them. This is who we are. We are people who are united under God, and we got to connect together to hear each other's stories and to grow together, because we are a church. We are one body, one nation, one baptism, right? Amen. Hey, if you're new here, welcome. Can you guys welcome our new people? Thank you. Yeah. Man, we are so glad that you chose to worship with us today. We love you guys. We want to connect with you. So if you see somebody with an orange name tag in the lobby and you're new, interrupt them. Tell them hello. Tell them I'm new. We want to tell you about our church and we want to get to know you. Man, I don't want to end. I don't want to stop. Can we just praise the Lord one more time? One more time. I know you're asking a lot. Man, what a celebration. Hey, here at the Village, we celebrate Jesus every week. We connect together and we care for the community around us. If you guys can help us by stacking the chairs 7 high, that would be great. Meet somebody new on your way out. We'll see you next week.
shining light, there's a fortune I inherit. I know work I have done, my righteousness I forfeit at my Savior's cross. We're all sufficient, merit did what I could not. In love he condescended, eternal now in time, a life without a blemish, the Maker shall be my father.